I call this together to firstly report on the state of SA Linux in unstable, and to explore the possibilities of what we could do for the Debian installer for Edge, as far as SA Linux is concerned. The state of support at the moment is everything except policy, the reference policy for SA Linux is in place and mostly bug-free. The problems that we are having with policy is partially because the SA Linux security community, we are moving from the old security policy that NSA had provided, basically to jumpstart SA Linux, and which has been unmaintained for the last 6 months to a year now. The new policy is based on the lessons learned from the old NSA policy. It is modular. It is, so think about it as kernel modules. You can have different modules. There is a base module that is basically compiled in. That is what you get by default. Apart from the base module, you can have any number of policy packages, policy modules. Apache, for example, can be split out of base and put into its own loadable module. The way that I envisage, once we split it out, would be that it would be something maybe like the menu system. Every package dumps in something into a directory describing what the policy package is, what the file name is, what the policy does. Some kind of user interface would be provided that allows the admin to select whatever policies they want to deploy. And then the policy would be like menu, it will be compiled and loaded at the end of the run. The policy packages that we have now are the latest packages that are available. Unfortunately, the part that combines multiple packages and links them is very, very buggy. And at the moment it crashes on the reference policy as of last week. It was working 2 weeks ago. Broke last week. Hopefully it will be working again next week. Once we get something which is working, I will obviously snapshot that version of the tools and policy and only upgrade new ones into sets that work. What else about the policy? Right. If you have multiple modules, there are module dependencies, obviously. If something needs some other bit of, they'll closely follow package dependencies, but not quite. The dependency tracking mechanism of SE modules, the one that links them all together, is part of the bricket. So, at this point, unfortunately, I can't say that I have a working SE Linux box. I had a working SE Linux box virtual machine 2 weeks ago, when I was getting all gung-ho about doing it. Joey, you had some questions about where we stand in
I guess the kernel is already, I mean, the current, the actual Debian kernel supports SE Linux, right?
Yes, it does.
So,
but every kernel that comes out has modifications for SE Linux.
Uh-huh.
We've got modifications that are coming out in 2.6.17. There are already other patches that have been queued up for 2.6.18.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they are in the MM1 series already.
Uh-huh.
Or they were scheduled to be in the MM1 series. Yes.
You said something about there being a problem with 2.6.16 and the current stuff.
Right. The 2.6.16 kernels and the current toolchain is broken. Part of they will be fixed in 2.6.17 before. But that means
that fix, the toolchain fix will be dependent on 2.6.17.
Right, yeah, because there are some facilities that the SE modules need that might require changes in the kernel code. There was some debate about that. I haven't been following the SE Linux mailing list to see if the consensus has changed yet, whether the changes in 2.6.17 are required or not. But the chances are that since we are in such a state of rapid development, actually there are a couple of companies, IBM being one of them, they're spending a couple of million dollars to have the US government certify SELinux enabled Red Hat boxes, Red Hat Enterprise Linux running, SELinux, to a high level of equivalent to the C2 Orange Book, though they call it something different now, the common criteria certification. Because of that, there are all kinds of things that are turning up, which would be nice to have, which haven't been put in yet, but now that crunch time is on us and we do want to get the certification, because this would be a big win for Linux, getting that certification. So we are putting in changes that, like multi-level security. Multi-level security is basically don't read up, don't write down. That means if you are security level 1, and there is a higher security level, like top secret, which is level 2, you can't read from the higher security level, but you can't write to a lower security level, because you have confidential information, you can't write to the open space. So, don't read up, don't write down is actually my bastardization of the build-up or paper of 76. That's the kind of thing that we're building in. So you can have documents which are at certain levels in your home directory, and when you are running at a certain security level, you'll see the high-level document. And then if you change your security level to something lower, you can no longer read your own document. So you can provide, every user can provide security zones for themselves. I mean, you can be sure that if I were to use Thunderbird, it will go into the lowest security level that I can create in the system. There are 256 levels that are possible. I think this was way too much information.
And I asked you before, if you knew how much, what the size was of the SELinux toolchain that we would need to run the system if we wanted to just support basic SELinux. Is it just SELinux utils and policy and...
policy core utils.
Policy core utils. Oh, okay. So SELinux utils is like 350K. Policy core utils is. Am I reading this right? Yeah. Oh, not a meg. Depending on the version. Yeah, the new version's a meg. And then, is that all? SELinux basics?
No, that's the meta package that pulls in.
Okay.
Actually, look at what the dependencies are.
So, check policy is the other one.
Policy
core utils and SELinux utils is all at once, and then it recommends SE tools and SELinux policy default.
Forget the defaults then.
Okay.
That's going
check,
to be.
Check policy is 280K. And,
I had estimated about 2 min.
I think 2 min sounds about right. Mm-hmm. And if we wanted the default policy, that's big. That's 5
no.
Okay.
That's the
reference policy, I guess.
Well, the reference policy, unless new has been processed in the last couple of days, would be called SELinux policy, ref policy strict.
I'm looking at SELinux policy default.
Yeah, that's the old NSA monolithic, everything combined policy.
Okay. So that wouldn't be what we don't put.
Let me find out, and I've got them here. Can you read a USB drive?
Sure. But then I can read it. Am I going to tear it apart if I open it wrong? Give me an idea.
Yeah. You have to pull the rubber off from that pen.
Then
I got
catch
it.
The arc on camera.
Is there a point to what I mean?
So what's on here?
No, there should be a directory at the top level called cache, C-A-C-H-E.
Okay.
And in that you'll find a whole lot of dev files.
Uh-huh.
Only one of those need be loaded.
So say that again, I'm sorry.
C-A-C-H-E, cash.
Oh, cash, gotcha. And right, okay.
And look, just do a LS start right there.
Yeah. Okay. Right, so the ref policy is 214K, and the strict is 474K deb size.
Well, by default, if you give them targeted policy,
it unpacks to 9 megabytes.
Hmm?
It unpacks to 9 megabytes. This the length of policy strict, right? That, you said that's the one, that's the links for policy strict would be the core.
That
policy.
Would be nice to have, but even the targeted one, which is smaller.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, so that one's, 6 megs installed. Okay.
So it's definitely under 2 megs of devs.
And it installs to about 10.
I don't know how much of a showstopper that is.
Yeah, I think it's worth dealing with that size. It would be better to have it. Or have it be in standard and just, I don't know. It's sort of on the verge of too big to be adding to the base system of every system, including
So how about the optional part of the installer?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That could work, but we would probably not want to ask the question as default priority.
The question would be the UI to
That would be go to medium priority and expert installs.
Or something.
So it would be available.
Well, actually the other way that we could do it and manage to talk about, since you do have the modular system. And if we have a module for Apache 2, for example, and a module for Bind, and a module maybe for Cups, then if you select those, if you say, I want a web server, then we could give you a web server with SE Linux installed.
Joe, what we also could do is make a task out of it.
Yeah, I know
check,
we can do a
check,
task
check,
out of
check,
it.
Check if the task is installed in Postgres config, and then do the changes needed in the boot model config.
Well, yeah, or, I mean...
That's going to be fairly complex, though.
So I think that it'll have to just be grep install, it'll have to be modified if we're going with the boot menu approach. See, what I was thinking, let's wait for that though.
Getting out the policy, the challenges in that route are the developers. They'll have to figure, if they are putting the policy in their packages, they might balk at putting in something that they don't really...
Have you thought about just having Apache 2 SE Linux policy package, for example? You could do that.
We could do that.
Yeah. So, how does the task idea feel to you of having it pulled in? So if you want a web server, you get it with SE Linux. But if you install a desktop, you don't get SE Linux. If you install a base system with no task selected, no SE Linux.
Would there still be a mode in the expert install where I can say...
Maybe. I have to really think about how to do that. I've had some issues with...
Alright. We've got SE Linux Basics package in there.
Uh-huh.
Is there some way in an expert install where at a medium priority I can indicate that, yes, I do want that package to be installed?
At the moment, we're limited to letting you select things with task install.
Okay.
And you can proceed with more things.
That's true. You could proceed it, but that's not the right approach.
That's kind of...
It's too hard.
I can look at
letting task install offer you more tasks.
Let's explore one more possibility. Right now, I've got my targeted policy with every possible module I can think of installed in.
So if we just have an Apache policy.
I've got Apache policy, I've got bind policy, I've got every single policy I can think of in there.
Understand. So let's look at an outlet partner policy.
So I'm saying I can create a base policy module which is as small as you guys want it to be, so I can slide in under the bar.
Right, okay.
So tell me what the bar is.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the bar is, but...
give me a ballpark figure where I'll have a better chance.
I'm going to mention something like 2 minutes.
Installed or 2 minutes depth?
I'm thinking installed. Depth would be more like 3, but it doesn't really matter that much now.
Next is an interesting basically. It's,
okay, I think I can... it will be a concept similar to a UDEP style thing. I throw out all the documentation and you will get the documentation when you do
all
the thing is that we need to include it. We have to look at that site too because we need to include it on the NetInst and
the
smaller...
because it's 256 megs.
Yeah, but also the first full CD. You cannot dumping stuff
into
you
do eventually push stuff out with the full CD. Put a CDX on and it might be pushing out an Emacs or Vim or something like that. So
Vim, I wouldn't mind.
Well, that, there's a reason I mentioned both of them.
Well, I'll try and see if I can get something which is functional under 2 meg.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it might be that what you get in that is you only get the absolute base part. You don't actually get any policy modules. And maybe, as an example, I'll throw in an Apache policy.
Well, would there be any advantage to having a system with just that installed on it? Or would you still have to go install additional modules for...
Well, then you get to pick and choose what module, what policy you want. But you at least have a functional SK Linux box that will complain about everything that you do. But you can just ignore those warnings until... I see what you mean. You don't want everybody to have a whole bunch of warnings turned on that unless they're interested in it.
Yeah, I mean, if they boot up and they say, okay, I want SC Linux, I turn on SC Linux, and all it does is complain at me, and it doesn't add any security to the system, I don't know if that's really a useful...
I'll get you some... Well, there will be some security. Because the policy is... with the targeted policy, I will give... you will get some security, you just won't get... all the security modules that we have. So we can have a SC Linux policy, def policy base. That base gives you a certain amount of protection. And at this point, I'm not sure how much I can put in your
base. But we could still add on to it. We could still
and then you install additional SC Linux policy, def policy,
If you install Apache, the Apache task, the web server task can still pull in the full policy for Apache.
Right.
People that are serious about setting it up will go looking for the additional policies anyway.
Right.
Look, they're all going to be called SC Linux policy, def policy, foo. So you look it up in Aptitude, they're all going to be right there, you can pick whatever you want.
Yep.
So I'll just have to figure out the granularity of these policy packages. And in order to do the granularity, I've got to fix the tool chain.
So
that's your problem.
So if we have some idea about what we want to install and basically how to do it, I guess the other question is how does this get turned on after it's installed?
If we can do something in grubconf.
Right.
Now the grubconf, if you say SC Linux equal
one thing, we're not only talking about grub, of course. We have to install all platforms and all bootloaders.
So what I'm talking about is standard kernel. We can compile our official kernels are compiled such that you have to say SC Linux is equal to 1 in your bootloader in order to turn it on. Even when you turn on SC Linux, nothing actually happens, it just yells at you. Okay. Then you have to say enforcing equal to 1 in order to actually have it turn on the security. I don't think we are at a point now, we are too close to the release, we can't work out the issue so that to change this default. So, if the user has installed all these policies and everything, nothing happens. They have to change the bootloader. they say still Linux is equal to 1, then there's something happens and maybe they don't get any security. But it's available for them. And now if they want more security, people who are in the know, who are interested in ASC Linux, can go and add on additional policy modules. And I can create any number of, basically creating a new ASC Linux policy is just, there is a modules.conf file for ASC Linux policy building. You throw out the modules, you can say something is a module, it is a base. And I think like we can fine tune the sizes to at least get something out there for people. And let me work on it for a month. We'll maybe meet again on IRC or something to figure out if it's worth it, the security that I can provide in something which installs in this day 2 meg. The other thing that can be done is I don't give you a binary policy, I give you a source policy. So the most of the stuff that you see in there is because I've already compiled it into a loadable binary model.
Right. Oh, I see.
But what I can do is I can do, give you a reference policy source of certain thing. And then in the post-in, the user or provide a command or in the post-in somewhere or something, user who has elected to install a CMS policy can run SC modules, link all these things and give me a running policy.
That doesn't address the base problem that you would have 10 megs used on the Intel system.
The binary,
well,
the
yeah,
binary is a big binary. So if the source thing is small,
yeah.
So the install on the default install is still small.
Yeah.
But anybody who wants to use it will end up using up stuff on their.
If it's not compiled until it's turned on,
right.
It will be good. But if it's going to be compiled to install anyway,
no. Look, the user has to. I am not going to dump a compiled policy ready to be loaded on any machine because if it happened on my machine, I would want to kill somebody. Nobody loads policy on my boxes until I give the say so. And I assume that my users, anybody who is running a Linux policy, want that level of control. So no, nothing gets compiled and installed by default, it's user action. H plus one, we might come and revisit this. But H plus one is like 2.5 years away. What, I thought we were on a 2 year
schedule. Is that an
right?
Official timeline?
Well, we might know about
it. Yeah, we are.
Okay.
So,
well, so it's 2 years away. In 2 years, we'll be a lot further along.
Yeah.
Either we'll be a lot further along with SC Linux or SC Linux will be dead. If it doesn't take off soon.
Security through death.
Look, security is hard. There's nothing else out there that gives you anything comparable. But it is hard. And if it doesn't get deployed by the distributions, it's not going to take off. Red Hat is doing a lot of good. Gentoo is going to deploy it in their next major release. SUSE is going to deploy it in their next major release. They just deployed,
so
there was a lot of
quiet for that.
They are also talking to Traces.
Okay.
So they are hedging their bets. Because AppArmor has got a lot of very negative commentary inside the security community. It's a joke. It's you get a warm, fuzzy feeling, but you don't get any real security. It's not in the same class of security as the population we were talking about.
Yeah. Well, you've been talking about that you need a kernel later than 2.6.16. It's going to exist in 2017. But you've probably read the discussion on Debian kernel about adopting the 2.6.16 kernel for Edge because it's going to be long-term maintenance. So you'd have to make sure that those patches, those changes, make it back into the kernel maintained by Microsoft.
I can backload the fixes. Right? I can maintain kernel images for the architectures that I can compile on. I can probably go to the build system and compile for various architectures. It would be really nice if the current, the SE Linux backward patches were accepted by the kernel team.
I think you need to get them into microbanks. Maintained version of 2.6.16.
Michael Banks version or the kernel team is SVN?
No, no. 2.6.16 is going to be forked basically and going to have a stable upstream maintenance team. That is led, that's an initiative led by Michael Banks. Sorry? Adrian Boom, sir.
Adrian, well, I can try. It depends on how conservative they are and how much importance they place on SE Linux.
Yes. But that, that looks like, at this moment, to be the kernel that's going to be set for Edge and is going to be keeping getting updates, maybe even other drivers or driver fixes for about 3 years. Which makes it perfect for the lifetime of Edge.
Okay, that's a complication. I'll have to talk to you. Okay. We have a decent working relationship, so it depends on how much, how intrusive these 2.6.17 patches are.
The, there will probably be a book about this later this week, about kernel selections and such relationship with Debian Installer. So please try to attend that.
I'll be there. All right, even if it is not in the default install and it is made into a task.
Well, we really, if it's going to be in a task, we really want it to be installed. Otherwise, you're just playing it, actually supporting it. You're not really supporting it to the extent that an end user is going to get it without a lot of fiddling. So you can't say Debian supports SE Linux out of the box, you know. So.
Well, yeah, it could become an optional add-on.
Yeah.
And it doesn't have anything to do with the installation itself anyway, so there's no need to integrate it with the installer itself.
Exactly. You have to build
it just has to do with the target system. And that's what Task Shell is for, basically. Installing packages into the Task target system.
Well, actually,
in addition to the base system.
How much of GNOME KDE is actually on the system at the end of your Debian install run?
Did you ask how much of it?
Yeah.
Currently, if you pick the desktop, it has a large
right. So if you pick a task, it is supported,
right.
But
yeah.
If you don't.
Right. But we can't really have tasks changing out the default kernel from underneath this.
No.
So
No. I totally agree about the. It has to. I was just hoping that we can have a Debian patch on top of the 2.6.16 Debian bump upstream. Because right now we do have a ton of patches that we apply on our own. And I was hoping to sneak in a tested security patch, which may not make Adrian Bump's requirements, but might match ours.
Well, that's a nice discussion you wanted to have with the
You guys have insurance.
We take what they get us, basically.
You guys have influence, and I would like to talk to the kernel team about this.
Okay, Manoj, I think the one thing that you said before is that you'd like to have SE Linux and Debian be a soft release requirement for Edge.
Yeah. Yes,
did Steve come in a minute ago and leave or something? Where's Steve go? He was here or something. Oh, there he is. Hi, Steve. So, soft release requirement for Edge, what do you think?
Andy and I have both already talked about it intensively, agreed that yes.
Okay, so we have some push behind.
You realize that with me, Steve, and Andy, if you count the technical
That's not good.
AJ, I also talked to AJ, who has also tentatively agreed, so that's yet another tech committee member who's tentatively on board. So I've been trying to line up the ducks in a row when it comes to the powers that be in Debian in order to get the security patch. I'm knowing the way that we operate, I'm sure that even if we are using Adrian Bunk's repository in our upstream, there will still be Debian patches in the Linux kernel.
Yeah.
And if I can persuade, I've talked to Dan Frazier, and I think he's on board, so I've got one duck there. If Sven Luther is back on the team, I might have issues.
He hasn't left the team.
Okay, then I need somebody to mediate for me. I'm sorry, but I'm
AJ's going to be mediating. I said AJ is going to be mediating. Sven has many good things to say about his mediation skills.
Well, it's unfortunate, but yes, there have been friction between the kernel team and I in the past, and I need help.
Well, we are not the best people to be the for you.
Was the Edge installer going to have a 2.4 option?
Depends on whether the 2.4 kernel ships with Edge. If it does, it probably will. If it doesn't,
so many architectures, it's already atrophied or dropped.
HPA 964,
Alpha, we're not supporting a 2.4 kernel.
But you know, if there is somebody who puts the 2.4 kernel in there, I will make that solder and maybe use it. So,
but supporting a 2.4
kernel yet, it's needed to support 2.4.
Right.
We kind of dragging our feet until release managers and kernel team make a really final decision on it.
Well, I mean, the existing kernel team seems to have no interest in actually doing
that. Yeah, but they still haven't removed it from the archive either. So.
That's right.
and they should do that before the freeze, after the freeze, it's too late.
Yeah,
they move back
exactly.
Like
yes. But 2.4 is basically, there's nobody, it's quite a deal to support that because you basically don't even have any upstream security support anymore. So is it really feasible to support that on new systems for Etch, or do we need to say if you need a 2.4 kernel, you have to run an older install of Debian because we can't provide security support at all?
Can't you backport to 2.4 after the install?
Thanks. Can you backport the time?
Well, that's an option that I think has been discussed as well, to keep the 2.4 kernel source and say, okay, use at your own risk.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you were saying.
It's a kernel.org, debian.org. It's just the source.
What's the point of that? Plus, if we know ahead of time that we are not going to be able to provide security support for it, I really don't see the value in putting that in a stable release. Because that's what stable gives you, is it gives you the security and the non-stability. You get the stability, but you have the stability with Sarge too, because that's not going to change out from under you either, so why not just start from there and do a dist upgrade or whatever. Unless a group of people come forward and say, yes, we're going to do the work to make sure 2.4 is still working, yes, we're going to provide the support that the security team needs in order to make security updates available for the 2.4 kernel, I don't see any way that we could do that for Edge. So the existing kernel team has not said they want to do it. The security team does not have the resources to do that on their own. They have enough problems with just one. And right now they have enough problems with two, and that's with 2.4 being not quite as stale as it will be when Edge releases.
Is there anyone who is wanted? Has anyone indicated to us or to the team that they want 2.4? Maybe not even wanted.
So they want to maintain it or they want to use it.
I mean, does anyone want to use it?
I still use it on my server, so I have to travel 1,000 miles to upgrade.
there's an issue with the 2.6 install on Sarge with the Mega Raid. I don't know. I think that's been resolved in the beta Edge install.
There's a number of issues. There's some areas in the kernel that, because it's all the hardware, is not maintained as well as the rest of the kernel. So you have issues like ACPI not working, or an APM not working anymore in 2.6 where it did work in 2.4.
Yeah, I have a hardware that 2.6 is not working on.
Yeah.
PCI SCSI cards are still working.
HTTP hardware
and
doesn't.
Well, we've just learned in the beef book what you can do with the hardware, so.
That's right. So, yeah, I mean, I'd just rather see it here from the archive to be that, have that be the trigger rather than us scurry around with it from the DI before it's out of the archive, which is my preference. So, if I could get back to something else, SE Linux, after it's installed by DI, do we want to come up in the grub menu as an option to boot with SE Linux enabled?
That would be nice.
Okay. I mean, it's obviously easy to do. You just make grub installer, add another menu item, and you, you know, that's it. I mean, you don't have to do it for other bootloaders, maybe. If there are any other ones that offer a menu, maybe it's all boot or something, but otherwise, you just pass it to the command line, of course.
And if we provide no option, there will be no condom.
That's right. Our kernel is currently shipping with SE Linux.
Right, it just adds the visibility that yes, the system does support SE Linux.
Yes.
I enable it.
I guess you also have to read me a Debian file?
I will have by the once I get these things in. Yes, the documentation, if you're going to do this, I will take that action item. I will provide the documentation to for users. Not that I want to, but yeah, I'll do it. One other thing that I came up with, the targeted policy, the strict policy that we just saw, they have tagged policy for packages that are in optional, and even policy for packages that might be next time. One way of logically slimming down the policy is if you're going to install by default, I only provide policy for packages that are in standard. And then everything else goes into the either add-on package or a patch.
Yeah, see the policy for an NetD, that's
right.
Exactly.
But we won't install Apache and 9NetD and all the things that are bloating up my policy by default anyway. The user has to take some action to select that. And the same action can pull in the SE Linux versions. There is also there is something called /etc/selinux.conf that can optionally say which policy you want to follow. So, and this is just an idea I'm throwing out. I'm not sure where I'm going with this totally. We can create our own policy. There is targeted, which is basically what Fedora does. There is strict, which is the gung-ho, do everything, secure everything policy. And then we can have a policy type called Debian or Debian pre-installed or something. And that's what we ship, and that has minimal targeting. We can do all that stuff. And if people want to go to standard targeted or strict, they can go and change things in /etc, which is what admins do anyway.
Mm-hmm. Or just have get install as the Linux policy or policy.
Somebody mentioned on IRC that they wanted to have a package called SE Linux instead of SE Linux Basics, where because people would otherwise not know how to get SE Linux if you could do apt-get SE Linux, and there we can also, that would be an appropriate use of DevCon's questions to figure out what policies you might have. Want and then it will pull in other packages or other modules that are already on the system to load it into your running policy. And that package can depend, recommend, and suggest various other packages. So that can also be, would that work with the tasks or if this is a complementary?
Yeah, I mean, if you ask a DevCon question, we'd want to look at the question because we don't want to have lots of random questions that are asked at high priority. If it's asked at medium priority or something.
Priority.
Yeah, and I mean, and they can always just depackage or configure SE Linux after the install and configure, that'd be great.
Right. The SDN chipset shouldn't be in the Debian installer. This meta package.
Huh.
I was thinking the meta package gives you the stuff that we talked about.
Uh-huh.
Then for people who want to have a real SDLinux installer, they can do an apt-get install SDLinux, which is a meta package that pulls in various packages, has dev confessions of its own, helps you figure out what you want in your policy, give you help and stuff. But it would not load our Debian installer, won't necessarily need to be on the first CD. But it gives a, we can point people to that package if you want a user-friendly install of SDNX, extended SDNX capabilities. Please install that package and follow the directions that DevConf has to do. So the reason I want to do this in this way is that give me a little bit more leeway in slimming down policy even more, because all we're saying is we're giving you a system that is capable of running SDLinux. We're giving you all the packages that you require to run a hardened Debian server installation, for example. And we will give you a nice, easy way to set up your server by installing the SDLinux package, which is not installed by default. We are not going to claim that we are going to have a SDLinux box out, running out of the box. At least, I'm not comfortable with giving you guys assurances that I can deliver on that promise. I would like to see this darn thing working for couple of months without checking on me before I commit to that. So if I could just get enough in so that by default you've got something that I can bootstrap into a stronger policy, a hardened box, I think that would be enough for us to say that we support SDLinux in the Debian installer. It's not on by default, you've got to take a series of steps to harden your box, but they are all within the package management.
So then you're going to provide policies via backports then? Because once the list of packages, you know, is frozen for Etch, you know, you're supporting SE Linux, but if you don't have these policies kind of finalized or tweaked out or, you know, solidified.
SE Linux policies are not going to be finalized or tweaked out in less than a decade from now. So, yes, we have to
plus two.
But you can
do it for now.
You
can do it for a second. Edge plus two.
You can probably use volatile.
Right.
You don't have to go to backports.
Is volatile up yet? Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, it's been up for a year.
Okay. I haven't used it.
Yeah, but they're fairly essential,
yeah.
And I hear that quite a lot of people are making use of them.
Are they this is a rabbit hole, are they antivirus packages or what?
Yeah. Antivirus, it's going to be updated for time zone information now that it's been split out of GCC.
Sure.
And there is whois information.
Okay.
Stuff like that. And I think security policies fit in fairly nicely with that. But talk to Andre as well about it.
I'm not there yet. Okay.
So we continue this on email, then in boot?
Once I've got something, a non-broken SDLinux, I'll think later on Debian Dev will announce. Pointing to the modified version of my talk today, which gives full instructions, I'll have so people can set up the UMS, etc. And at that point, I'll probably come back to you guys and send mail on the mailing lists to say that this is what I have got for Facebook. Do we have a restriction on what the length of package names can be?
The whole policy is in the file name.
So think about It's in the next policy. So you can see that they watch it.
Keep it readable in that. That's basically it.
Oh, that's already.
No, that's. It depends on how wide the aperture.
Yeah, normal screen size.
Okay, that's high. Well, it's in the next policy, left policy, strict base.
The policy there twice.
Yeah.
Well, because this is. Well, SE Linux policy, SE Linux, so the Bishop system, this is the policy part of it, this is not the utilities or blah blah. The name, upstream name of this particular branch is called the reference policy, so ref policy. Then the type of reference policy, which is strict, then the subset of strict that we are shipping, which is base. Or I can go back to my old Unix roots and just, you know, ship the acronym. But yeah, I think I'll. If I split it out into base and non-base, I might slide in under the 2MIG installed.
I guess one thing. I mean, one thing that we do have to be careful about is people getting a false sense of security by just installing this default thing and saying, "Oh, my system is now secure."
Yeah.
We'll have to.
But they can't do it. Look, since it's not coming in compiled,
yeah,
right. The time they compile it, they will realize.
I mean, as long as they're going to boot up and the kernel's going to be skewing error messages at them once they turn on the C line.
No, if they boot up, even if they turn on the C line, say, suppose they haven't done anything with policy.
Yeah.
You say SC Linux is equal to 1 and enforcing it to 1. SC Linux boots up, tries to load policy, says
yeah.
that you ain't got no policy, spits out a big fat warning, and then. Defaults back to non-SE Linux mode. So you won't have the assurance you're running policy until you have gone through these steps, and then you would know exactly what you have.
You could have a message too on the installer, like when you say like run on grub or run on bootloader.
Yeah.
You could have a message there too. Just saying.
Probably, yeah. I don't know exactly how, but yeah, it could.
Dan, one more list to subscribe to.
Well, you can ask for CCs too.
Now, that's a burden on the people. If I'm going to be needing your help, I'm asking for a favor, I subscribe.
It's a heavy list, be more.
I can ignore most of things. I follow Julie, this is, you know, look at the tree of, you know, thread tree, and then I.
Yeah. Well, you can filter out anything that's not important first until you've actually implemented it, then you have to track them for SPNX issues.
Yeah.
I thought you made your own special scripts for filtering people out.
No,
you said that you did.
I have got an AI that does it. I've got something that learns from my behavior.
That's
So my scoring, my message scoring system looks at whether I read an email or delete it. Well, usually I read emails. There are times when I kill a whole thread. And then there are times when I say, remove this from the backend. Any mail that I say remove from the backend, that person has to go a long, long way for me to read him again. You guys should. You know, all of you poor VI users, you really should look into Emacs and Gnus and.
Oh boy.
Emacs makes it so hard to have a good SE Linux policy that you're doing everything.
Oh. Right. By the way, Eclipse has a plugin that can read SE Linux policy that you already have, and it helps you with completion to write new SE Linux policy. If somebody was asking me about this and I forgot about it. This is one thing that has made me go for Eclipse. Bloated, slow, but it does a decent job of parsing all kinds of strange formats and providing completion.
By the way, the last time I used Emacs, I couldn't figure out how to get to it, so I ended up unplugging the machine.
But that was what happened to people who use VI. All right, are we done?